So let's start with what this is. I show you what all these things are and then we will see how to integrate with what you have. For that I will use his laptop because they can connect to your systems. Now we need some data to understand all this, so I'm going to take some very simple data, transactional data. And you keep the data simple, then you understand better. So this is my data. Transactional, every row is some transaction. Colombo, where it happened, how much amount, date, whatever, which type of credit card was used and what was it spent on. Simple data. Now the purpose is not to show you complexity of data right now. Purpose is to show you the purpose of all these tools which I mentioned. Now should I assume you know pivot table or should I show you what pivot table can do? That is the first question, because very often what happens, pivot table has been there for 25 years. These things have been there for 3 years or 1 year. So naturally, if at all you are learning something new, you will be tempted to learn the new thing. Nothing wrong with that, but we learn new thing with the assumption that whatever is old we already know, and that's never the case. So whatever benefit this offers is not being negated by this. This is incremental benefit. It is not a substitute to Power Pivot. Pivot table continues to have its own benefits, but these are additional benefits. What does that mean? When a new thing comes in the platform, doesn't make the previous thing irrelevant. It is equally relevant and you have incremental benefit. Normally we don't do that. We go behind fashion and only look at the new thing, and the new thing becomes old, then we go to the next new thing. That is a bad thing about how techies work. I have been a techie before. That's why I'm telling you. So let me start with pivot table, then we go further, because pivot table works on all versions of Office. That's the benefit. There's no if and but, there is no prerequisite, no add-in required. It's native. So if you can deliver a solution in pivot table, that is the most wide ranging solution, because everyone has the required infrastructure. So pivot table, everyone knows how to create. Now I'm just going to do a count. These are 880 cities. No, this is not a distinct count. This is just a count of rows. So now what does this mean? In my raw data, in the column called city, I have 880 cities. It still doesn't tell me whether there are 880 rows, because the city could have been blank. Understood? So that's the idea. Anyway. Now the question is, normally most users will get data incrementally. So now I'm going to just copy paste last 5 rows there itself. Now if I go to the pivot table and refresh, will it work? Will it show me 885? By default, no. Because you added rows doesn't mean pivot table knows the rows have been added. Whose job is it? It is your job to go to pivot table, you have to go to analysis, you have to go to change source, and range has to be manually updated. Most people do it, but if you forget it, then you are seeing long or outdated results. But now notice, I have not changed the range. How did it work? I did in front of you. I did not go to source and change the range. It worked because the raw data was not just a raw data. The raw data was a table. So now the question is, do you know what is a table in Excel? Obviously not. Otherwise you would have told me the answer. So what is a table in Excel? Do you use Excel as a user also? Or you never touch Excel as a user? So then you desperately need to know table. Because in table, in Excel, whether you are programming it or you are using it, there is always a concept of defining a range. And then you work on the range. For example, this was the source data for the pivot table. That was a range. Now what happens in real life is, if you don't have a defined range, life becomes very difficult. For example, here I have simple data, lots of data, and I want to copy the formula. The tax is whatever, 3%. I have already put a formula which says C colon C, which will take all the calculations. I will calculate whatever tax and pay it. How do I copy the formula? Drag. How long? 1 million rows. That's what. So double click. Double click is good, but generally it is bad because you can't guarantee there are no gaps. This guy is dumb. It doesn't understand you double click. You hope that it will take it to the last row, but it is only a guess. Why is it not going to guarantee that you take it to the last row? Because you never told Excel where is the last row. You said, I don't bother to find out, let Excel find out. So Excel applies its own logic. Empty cell means it thinks data is finished. Now you are stuck. So both methods are wrong. So first step is to define the range. In older days we used to put a named range, but name range we have to use in a formula. For copying formulas it is of no use. So name range is no longer that solution. So you say insert table. Insert table is a way of freezing that range. Table requires very simple requirements, columnar data, and heading must not be empty or duplicate. That's all. No merge cells. No formulas in header. Once you do that, you get table tools. Now I can add the same formula, and then Excel doesn't ask me anything because it already knows the extent of the data. Just to make it more complicated, I am putting gaps right here, and I am going to the gap and writing the formula. B7 multiplied by whatever. Notice how intelligent it is. It assumes you want it, so it incorporates the column, formats it, and copies it to the bottom. That is the benefit of table. This is available for 7 years. Now, another benefit of table, when you have lots of data, you import it, you can't see it when you scroll. So you have to split and freeze pane. That is gone because when you do this table, what happens? See what happened. Are you noticing what's happening? That ABCD is anyway useless, so it is replaced with the proper names of the columns, and the auto filter drop down is also available here. So even if you are on the last row, you can get auto filter from here. Another benefit of table. One more benefit of table is generally you get raw data and then you have to add calculated columns. So suppose I want net amount as calculated column. Net amount is amount minus tax minus discount. How will I do that? I showed you the data just now. Which column is amount? Which is tax? Do you remember? No. You are never going to remember. Every day we open different files. So what choice do you have? Waste your precious life pressing left arrow 20,000 times. Correct? And even if you do that, what happens? So left arrow one time is okay, but if the data is large, again the second column you have to search for. Agreed? So one time scrolling is not enough many times, we have to do it multiple times. Anyway, we have done it now. Now it is a table, so it copies it. Doesn't matter, but what should be the formula now? A6 minus C6. Correct? No. Everything you think about first time in the context of office is always wrong or inefficient. Remember that. That's the best way to learn office. First thought which comes is inefficient. Don't even try it. What does this do? This is smarter now. This is a table. Why is the rule that table must have a unique column name so that you can use it in formulas? I didn't use it. Excel used it for me. But now I know. So what should I do? Next time onwards when I am about to add a formula, what should I do? I'm not going to waste my time doing this. What am I going to do? Use those names directly. Now issue. I want to delete this data. What should I do? I want to show you how to do it using the syntax directly. So I've already done it. So I don't want to put one more net column. I want to delete the data in the column called net. What should I do? Most of you will do this. Without realizing it, we have selected all the way up to 1 million. You have no clue whether there is some data there. We are just taking a risk. It's not going to give you any error message if you delete something. Because you are saying delete, so why should it give error message? So that is a risk. What we are interested in is deleting only data in the column called net, not in column called X. There is a difference. Now, how do you select column called net? Yes, you know all the shift and down arrow stuff. But remember, notice most of us have data touching the column headings in row 1. That is a bad idea. Always keep one empty row there. I'll tell you why. Now, you can learn by looking at the mouse cursor. This means regular selection cursor. This means drag cursor. This means move cursor. You know that. But we don't notice it all the time. This means select column X. We know that also. But we don't know that table has that guy here. That you would never have noticed because your rows are going to touch row 1. So if this was like this, you will never have noticed it because there is a very little small gap between the two. You will think that guy continued. But imagine someone has designed this interface with all this in mind. So now I select one click and then I delete. Got it? Now, what formula do I want to put? I don't want to go on the left. I can use column names. So now tell me exact column name. Was it amount or AMT? I don't remember. Although in this case you will remember because you have seen the screen thrice. In real life, you will not remember all the cryptic field names we give. So who is going to help you? So what is the syntax? Name should be in square bracket. So can we start the square bracket at least and then expect Excel to give you IntelliSense? That is what it does. This is another benefit of table. Now I have this large table. I have some blanks here. Now in some other summary sheet, I want to show total amount. What should I do? In the normal course of things, I will say sum nicely, open bracket, and then think how am I going to find where that data is. Correct? Now we do differently. We have already made sure every column has a name. Similarly, every table has a name. These names are generically given by Excel. It is a good idea to give it ourselves. Every time you create a table, give it a name. So life is good. Now what happens? Because this table is like this, I can say equal to sum, and square bracket should give me the list. No, because we are not in the table. So now I have to first identify the table. So the name of the table also appears there. And then you get the list. Now you don't care which sheet the table is in. But if you want to go to the table, you don't have to struggle. Open this drop down and it will take you to that sales table. So both ways it is beneficial for formulas as well as for navigation. Now all these benefits which you saw. One more I show you. This is the raw data I get every month, two columns, and based on that I have some calculated columns. Next month I am going to get more data and then I am going to copy paste it here. What do I have to do now? Extend these formulas manually. Correct? So whenever you are doing such things, you will get a feeling that you are helping Excel rather than Excel helping you. So whenever you get that feeling, that means your method is inefficient. Stop doing it and find a better way. So what is the better way? Make a table. You already know that. So when you make a table here, notice what happens. Expect as you expect it to be. Not only will it extend the table here, it will automatically extend the formulas. Now what is the learning out of this? When you get raw data and when you want custom columns, calculated columns to be added in the raw data, don't add them inside the data. Add them at the end. Only then this feature is going to help you. You understand what I just said? So you'll be very tempted to put net amount here because it's logical, this minus this minus this. But then next time the data comes, that is not going to have the net amount column. Then the data will mismatch. So all calculated columns always at the end. Why do we put them here? Because it is operationally convenient to do that formula. But now we don't care because the formula is syntactical. It is IntelliSense. So there is no compulsion to put it right there. Okay, so that all these are minor benefits of table. The major benefit of table is this problem. I am one person, I have a data, I have some formulas. I have put the formulas right now. I'll also put one formula for JFM quarter. That will be only 3 months. So far, no problem. Now this file I keep on SharePoint or some server. Someone else also opens it. So Imran also uses my file. Data is common, but he has put a separate formula. We don't talk to each other about the file. So I don't know about what Imran does. Imran doesn't know what I do. File is common. Now next month I'm going to add more data. And when I add more data, what is going to happen? Who will update the formulas? Me or Excel? You have to do it. Because Excel doesn't care. So you have to do it. Am I going to change this? Yes. Am I going to change this? Yes. Am I going to change this? This is first quarter. It's already Jan, Feb, March. Never mind, I add May and June. That is not related to that quarter. So I'm not going to change this formula. So which formula to update or not, it is your discretion. Excel doesn't know. But after this, I'm going to save the file and go home. I'm not going to update Imran's formula, which I should have. Why am I not going to update? Because I don't know about it. Imran never told me. So after a few days, Imran opens the file, assumes that this number is correct and this number is wrong. That is how we take wrong decisions in business every day. Without realizing it. And even if there is a business impact, auditor will never find this mistake, root cause. Understand the problem? So whose fault is it? Nitin or Imran? Or Excel? Excel, not a fault, because mathematically what it is doing is correct. The fact that we added something in D12 is an operational problem. That's why this is called operational risk. So how do you mitigate the risk? Excel is already helping you by giving you a warning. That green mark is a warning which you have been ignoring for last 12 years. So you look at it and you ignore it. That's called ignorance. You look at it, click on it and read it. That is called knowledge. So it's saying, just allow me, I will do your job. And then you'd get accuracy at the end of it. That is how you are supposed to use Excel. I just did a session in the morning for 35 CFOs. Second session I did was for Central Bank. Third session I did was for Ministry of Finance. Nobody knows this. And it's not only Sri Lanka. I've done sessions for 14 countries. Nobody knows this. And I've done sessions for Microsoft. They also don't know this. So whatever we do in office is called return on ignorance. Nobody has a clue. It's a miracle that things are working. And they're working at the cost of your life because you are ending up doing things the lengthy way. And that's why we say we are overworked. Because every action we do is inefficient. How will you have time? And who is losing? Not Microsoft. You are losing in the process. So you have to be very paranoid about every action you do using office. You have to assume it is inefficient and prove to yourself that it is efficient. That's the methodology or psychology called efficiency. Now having done this, your life has become better or worse. Now you know the meaning of green mark. So now what will you do to this green mark? If I say update it, this will become YTD, but I want only JFM. So in this case, I will not update it. It's discretionary. In this case, I'll say ignore. And because it is discretionary, you can't do this. Now, whenever you go back, you will see a lot of green marks. Earlier, you were happily ignoring them. Now you have knowledge, so you can't ignore them. So your life has become more miserable because you'll have to correct them. But actually, it has become better because your risk of taking wrong decisions is zero now if you do it. But problem is, now if I have seen 3 marks or something like that, suppose I had not ignored it, what would have happened? Notice what would have happened. There is one error right now. If I put more data, there will be more errors. I know I have to correct errors, but I will be tempted to select all and then update all. It doesn't allow you to do that. Now you will think Microsoft is sadistic. Why is it expecting me to go one by one? It is doing that because it is discretionary. This one I want to update. This one I want to update, but this one I want to ignore. If you had selected all, that was not possible. That's why it is discretionary. So what does that mean? From now onwards, every Excel file you open, it is your job to look at every error, correct it, and then take whatever interpretative action you want to take. So it's like a standard operating procedure. Open a file, don't trust anything, error checking first. And then do your job. Now who is going to take you to errors? Not manually searching, formulas, error checking. Excel knows where the errors are. So click there, it goes one, next one, next one. You choose update or ignore. Finally, it will give you a message that this sheet is accurate. You have to repeat this for every sheet of every Excel file before you trust anything. It doesn't matter who created the file. Now that we are error free, this is a good situation to be in, but that situation is going to last for 1 month only. All errors will come back when you add data. What does that mean? Every time you add data, there is an extra piece of work to be done. What is that? Error check. Problem. Why? Because anything which is repetitive is inefficient. We refuse to do anything repetitive. So now we have a problem. Right now we have no errors. I know I have to update data, but I am not willing to go and update formulas because from my point of view, it's waste of my time. It is dirty work. So dirty work should be outsourced. Remember, outsourced to whom? Expert in that field, which happens to be Excel. So now you select the data and outsource that work to Excel by creating a table. Now Excel will do your job. Now you don't have to remember all the dependents because Excel is already good at it. So if you go and look, all these Excel knows, so it has already updated all the references. You don't have to worry. In the process, what did you get? You got accuracy. So what is the process now? Open a file, do error check, go to the raw data and convert it to table and then do your work. This is called standard operating procedure for Excel. This is one of the starting points of standard operating procedure for Excel. Is this clear? This is the benefit of table. Now from a programmer point of view, if you get some input as Excel and you are parsing that input all the time, you spend in a loop trying to go from first row to last row, first column to last column, looking for endpoint. You don't need to do that if your input is in tables. Because table is called a direct object, called list object. And then automatically you get the range. You don't need to iterate to find the range. This is the worst thing we do as developers when you are using Excel as input and then you are going to process it. So use list object in all your programming. That is called table. Understood? So now questions. Anytime you have questions, stop me. Anything you want me to show again? Good?
Yes. On the tables, we have seen some optional to go to the table.
How to go to the table? Design. Table tools design, yeah. So when, how do you know you are inside a table? How do I know this is a table? Not because it's colorful, because right now it's a table. I can go and say convert it to a range. When you say convert it to a range, it keeps the color. Now it's not a table, but it's looking like a table. So don't go by the color. Now even if it's a table, there are lots of colors available. One of the colors available is called no color. Now it's not looking like a table, but it is a table. So don't go by color. Don't go by the auto filter. Auto filter can be put manually also. Don't go by this corner because you have 20,000 rows of data. Are you going to scroll to check whether it is a table? No. So click here and check whether there is a table menu. If that is the case, that means it's a table. Simple. So now pivot table. Oh, one more thing. Sometimes, because we never use table, we used to do formatting manually, correct? When you do formatting manually, what happens? Sometimes we do like this, some background, some foreground, some bold, something like that. And then now you feel like converting it to a table. See now what happens? I say insert table, Control T is the shortcut. You know the default is blue. But now this yellow doesn't go away. Why yellow doesn't go away? Because it was manually entered there. That means user has done it. The software cannot override what user did. So it has no choice but to keep that yellow. Even if though it is looking pathetic, it has to keep it. So now we know it is looking sad. We want to remove it. So how do you do it? You will manually go and say remove. Correct? So what did I say? Every thought which comes is inefficient. Don't do it. I have put formula, yes, I have put formatting. I am about to change the color. I want to tell this guy while I am trying to change the color, don't bother about my formatting. So right click there and surprisingly someone has thought of that option. Now it works. Why I'm showing this? Because this is a small table. In real life, you'll have done so much manual formatting, you'll spend the rest of your life removing that formatting. So that's why everything is thought of, and right click is the best way to learn. Normally you would never have thought of right clicking there. Correct? That's the idea. So right click wherever, whenever you get bored, go to unlikely places and right click. That is the way to learn. Now, pivot table. Now, first step is pivot table must be a table. Table must have a name. So now I'm just calling it expenses. Now when I say insert pivot table, just a visual cross check. When I am about to click on pivot table, table should be inactive. Why? Because I am already in a table. That's a quick way of checking whether I have made a table before creating pivot table or not. So now you go here, notice there is no range now. It's name of the table. Even if there was range, it will extend dynamically, but this is even simpler. Now, I drag drop this part, you know, so I'm not explaining. Now I want to see it as percentage. How do you see it? Too many numbers, difficult to interpret. How do you convert to percentage? No, you have attended my session. Come on. Let them suffer for some time. So you go here and put a formula, correct? Yes or no? And then what happens? Okay, let me show you. This guy comes. Nobody knows why this guy comes. Nobody even attempted to find out. There are two choices now. I press enter to find out what happens, or I press escape to run away from it. Which one is easier? Escape. So nobody pressed enter. So now next time you are going to manually do it, because you know I don't want to go there. You will type manually B4 divided by whoever that is, B16, dollar sign, done. Now you will double click. You don't want the 100, so you will remove that 1. And then you will apply formatting, correct? And then you get percentage. Job done, but at the cost of your life, remember. Who is helping whom? You are helping Excel. Not only that, you are not even helping properly. If I filter on something, what will happen? That grand total will move up. Then everything will become due by zero. You are not surprised, because you know this happens every day. You have a lot of time. You are born for doing such things. This is called inefficiency. You are doing Excel's job. Don't do that. But we never thought Excel can do this, because we never even had any hope from Excel. So when you want to know if Excel can do it, right click there and look at all the options. Which one? Summarize. Already some. Show values as. Now read all the options. Natural reaction is to press escape at this stage, but we have to read. Because escape is running away, reading is called knowledge. In this case, grand total and column is same, because we have only one column. But sooner or later you may add another column, so better to put column. Now you want both. What do you do? Amount again. Done. Now, did you notice there are many other options? But our job is done, so we are never going to read those options. That's how we work. Now, why did Microsoft put those options? Because they had some programmers on bench and they had to give salary and no other jobs. So they do something, so they did something. Is that how it works? No. Everything comes from a use case. So now you don't know the use case, because that's documented in Microsoft Redmond campus. But can you discover the use case? By a little bit of extra thinking, that is called efficiency. So discovering your benefit behind every small feature, button, option is called efficiency. Right now as a developer you are doing the other side, now you have to go the reverse. So now what does this mean? Percent difference from. So notice, right now the benchmark is 100 and everything is contributing to that 100. But I want to see, compared to May, how was April? Compared to May, how was June? That means I want to see difference between May and April, and then see difference between May and June, then see. That's called percent difference from. There is also a guy called difference from, but that is a little weird, because that still gives me numbers. Might as well convert them to percentage and make it easier to understand. That's why there is percent difference from May. Now it looks much better. This is not the same result from an interpretation perspective. This is a different picture of the data. This is a different picture of the data. Understand? So you know more about business. That is called business intelligence. So now every option here should be used in every piece of data, because each one of them gives you additional information. They are not mutually exclusive. Understand? Most people would use either this or that in a given report, because what is expected from them, that report. But if you continue to deliver reports on time, are you going to get incentive or growth? No. But if you find additional information which nobody knows, then you will grow faster. So this is how you do it. Apply every possible analytical tool to available data. Make your existing statutory report, keep it aside, and then find more information, attach it to that report, and then send it. That mindset you have to inculcate in the minds of people. Then people will understand what is BI. Are you getting the concept? I don't know what exactly happens, but typically what I've seen happening is you use BI tools, you create great reports, but people don't go beyond them. They are just copy-pasting those reports and working on them. Then instead of using SSRS report writer, you're using BO report writer. What is the difference? Maybe few more reports, but does it mean there are only few more useful information pieces? No, there are thousands of them lying there. Nobody is wanting to discover. That is the problem. So this is, the mindset is called BI, not tool is not called BI. Anyway, I don't have time to show you all of them, you explore them. Okay, now another thing, I'll take some other data to save time. Do you know what is Slicer? You know what is Slicer? Do you have SharePoint? Yes, you have SharePoint, right? So what is Slicer? I'll show you another example. Not this. What am I doing? Now I have multiple pivot tables here. One is by credit period, one is by type of customer, one is by companies listed or not. Three separate pivot tables. I want to filter them using something. So I want to filter them using segment. So I put it in filter area. Now I have done selection of one item, healthcare. Now this is filtered on healthcare. These are not. It is like a dashboard. So I should see cohesive data there. But right now only one is filtered, others are not filtered. So if I really want to see healthcare everywhere, what will I have to do? I'll have to click on each pivot table. In each of them, I'll have to drag the filter. And then manually I will have to select healthcare in all of them. Does that finish my problem? No, because sooner or later I am going to want another segment to be selected. So have I finished healthcare? Yes. But if I want something else, I will still have to repeat it three times. So that is the problem with traditional pivot table. They work in isolation. They have no linkage with each other than the fact that the data source is same. Another problem is if I do multi-select, I am doing telecom, retail and airlines. When I close, it says multiple items. Now I myself forgot what I chose. So that's a problem. So both these problems are now solved using Slicer. So what is Slicer? I'm just going to remove all the filters. You don't need them any longer. So you remove filter, remove filter, remove filter. Because now we have a common filter. That common filter is called Slicer. So you go to analyze and say insert Slicer. So it shows you the same fields, obviously raw data is same, and then it shows a floating window like this. So you can rearrange it, resize it, do whatever you like, so that as much as possible without scrolling you can see all the items. Now when I click on it, notice what is happening. This table is getting filtered because I added the Slicer in the context of that table. Others are still not affected, but Slicer got its own options. Slicer tools. So if you go to the Slicer tools and say report connection, now you can connect it to all the pivot tables or charts. Now I see only two extra pivot tables. Where are the others coming from? There are more pivot tables in other sheets. So you can actually connect it across sheets. And then I have a global filter. And multi-select is seen here. I can even drag this to multi-select. Drag, control, click, everything works. And when you publish it on SharePoint, this interactivity is retained. And this will work on any browser, including iPad or Android. Got it? Zero programming. Better dashboard. That is called slicer. Now we will go to new method of analyzing, which is power something something. But before that, do you have to clean up data sometime? It may not come exactly in the format you want, then you clean up. If it is database oriented data, you will do it in some ETL tool, but even manually you have to clean up in many cases in Excel itself. So how do you clean up better? To understand that, we have to understand what is good data. Good means data which does not require cleanup, which you already know. It should be like a table. Convert it to a table, life is good. But sometimes data is going to come in bad format. So we have to know the fastest way of doing that. How do you do that? Now I show you some data. Is this good or bad? Is it tabular? Yes. Does it have a header? Yes. Does it have consistent data? No. Now where did this come from? Typically this is a copy paste from a pivot table. Why do we copy paste as values from pivot table? Because you want to do some jugglery which the pivot table is not allowing you to do, because pivot table is very strict. So two problems here. If you have concluded that whatever you want to do, pivot table is not allowing you, you have just assumed that. Most probably you have not checked whether it can do. So first check. Pivot table is very powerful. We have not even scratched the surface in 25 years. If it is really not possible, then yes, you may have to copy paste. But in that case, while you are copy pasting it as values, you know that these gaps are going to trouble you after you copy paste, and then you are going to waste your life filling them up. So how do you fill them? How do you fill them? Lots of copy paste, correct? Repetition is bad. Don't even try it. Even in the mind, you know it is repetitive. Don't touch the keyboard. Stop and say, whose job is it to fill the gaps? Mine or pivot tables? Because the data came from pivot table. We never even thought that pivot table will have the capability of doing it. Now we have to think. Now question, should I right click or should I go to the menu? Because you are a developer audience, I am asking this question. Users won't understand this. We have to assume there is a solution. You have to discover the solution. Two ways of doing it. Right click or go to the top menu. What should I do in this case? What solution I am trying to say? Across the pivot table, I see a lot of gaps. I want to check whether this guy, means pivot table, can fill all the gaps. Go on top or right click. First thought wrong. Remember, no. Why am I saying no? Because right click is context sensitive, that's why it's called context menu. So if I right click here, the menu is different because this is data area. If I right click here, the menu is different because this is row area. What are we talking about right now? Are we talking about some row specific or column specific? No, we are talking about the overall structure of the pivot table. So there is no way it will be in a right click menu. The context is global, that's why we go on top. So now, is it a design problem or analysis problem? If you don't know, then you have to see all the menus. By filling the gaps, is it going to improve anything in analysis? No. So it is a design problem. Now what does it give you? This, which is useless from our point of view right now. Are we adding subtotals? No. Are we adding grand totals? No. Report layout, I don't know, so keep it pending. This sounds very interesting because it has the word blank in it, but remember, we have nothing to do with blank rows, we are talking about blank cells. But now you have got attracted to it, I will show you how bad it is. It adds more blank lines there, but anyway, you learned that there is availability of that feature. So what is remaining is this, and surprisingly, 5 years back, Microsoft did this. This was in 2010. One click fills the gap, you don't have to do anything. That is how Microsoft is noticing problems users are facing. They could have added this feature in first version of pivot table, but they had not noticed that problem. Now people did that so often, Microsoft said, let's not waste their time, let me add a feature. So lots and lots of things in pivot table, and this is how you clean bad data of this type. Now there is another kind of very bad data which you get, which in fact you create many times, that is called cross tab. What is a cross tab? There are row headings and there are column headings. That is called a cross tab. There is a horizontal table and there is a vertical table mixed together. Typically, this is an output from a pivot table or a grid report in any report writer. But if this comes as an input, then this is bad format. As an output, it may be a good format. So now if really I want to check is this good or bad, of course I have to put some type here. So expense type is the heading, these are the expense types. So what is the rule of good data? It's like normalized data. There should be a heading and consistent data in the column. So now is it good? Heading and data. So this column is good. How about this column? It looks good, but actually it's not good because this is not a heading. This heading should have been month. Instead of the heading, data has come there. That's a mistake. So ideally we should have three columns, expense type, month and amount, correct? Now who is going to do that and how are we going to do that? How are we going to do that? Copy and paste, correct? And then this one we'll have to copy all the way to December and then again come here and paste special transpose. This handled one row, we still not done, we'll have to double click this. Then you go to the second row and repeat that process. Efficient? No. Whose job? Excel. So now for this purpose Excel created a new tool. That tool is called Power Query. It is an add-in, you have to install it. Microsoft add-in. Now this guy is like a mini ETL tool. It gets data from various sources. Browser, web services, standard files, XML file, even from a file folder, all kinds of databases. SharePoint list, REST or Atom feeds, Azure, HDFS, HD Insight, Exchange, Active Directory, Facebook and SAP. And of course this has a language of its own. If you know the language you can write the query yourself. Now the simplest form of data this guy can import from is from Excel itself. So we have this data here. So I'm going to click in this data and say import from Excel. This requires a table. This is not a table, so it creates it. Now this has its own user interface, Power Query. Right now it has just imported the same data and it not done anything. But we know we want to keep this column as it is and we want to rotate these columns from Jan to December vertically. So it's like a paste special transpose but done globally. So you right click there and say unpivot columns and then it does the job. Understand? Do you have an ETL process to do that in your tools? Unpivot? There must be a process somewhere. Same thing. Of course it doesn't know what name to give it. So what do you give it? You want, that is your job. And then whatever. But remember, this is also storing your steps. This is automatically recording sort of a macro. I don't have to activate it. It is auto activated. You can't disable it. And it has a language. What I just did is this syntax. What I did unpivot is this syntax. Understand? What I did earlier is this syntax. So actually if you know the language, you can go to advanced editor and this is what we just did. Alright, so this is one method of cleaning up data. Do you copy paste data from web pages sometimes? Tabular data from HTML pages. It could be output of a report or it could be some random web page outside in the world. That is also taken care of now. So I am just searching list of cities in Sri Lanka. So I get some pages. I have to go to each page to find out which one has tabular data first. And even if I get tabular data and if I select it and copy it, it's going to create problems for me because it's not going to give me clean data. It's going to give me hyperlinks, wrong formats, JavaScript, whatever, images, junk. So not my job to clean, it is Excel job to clean. So what do? Go to Power Query even in this case. Power Query has its own browser, specialized browser for tabular data built into Excel now. Type the same query here. Now this doesn't give you, I'm not connected, sorry. This doesn't give you all search pages. Microsoft has made a list of curated web pages. But it is worth trying. Now if you have SharePoint, you can have internal sources also. Give me a minute to connect. I hope I have bandwidth here. No, I think it's showing me 3G, so that should be enough. We'll take a second to connect. Any questions so far?
Doctor, I think on pivot also we have this functionality to import data from ODBC.
Yes, it is still there. That is not gone, but that supports ODBC OLEDB only. It doesn't support all the newer ones like HD Insight, Exchange, Active Directory, SharePoint List, REST feeds, all that. So if you have a choice, you should use Power Query, even if there is an overlap. Now the issue is Power Query does not support ODBC OLEDB because there is already something native there. Okay, so they don't overlap. Eventually they may add it. But never mind. So now I am doing Power Query based search. It is still a web search, but now what I get are the results which Microsoft already knows those pages has tabular data in it. Step number one. Second, I still want to check which one I want. I may still have to click and open. No. Now in a mouse hover event, it has already done the job. Look at the user interface. Look at the behind the scenes programming which went into making this happen. This is called user convenience. But even then, it is saying don't get all the data because you may not want some columns, some data types may be wrong. So typical user attitude is let me first get the data into Excel and then do all the struggle. Now Microsoft is saying don't do that. First clean it and then get it. Now what is the benefit of that? Maybe these pages had thousands of rows of tabular data. This is not showing you all the data. This is showing you first n rows. So that you can preview it, decide what cleaning operations are required, and then when you say load the data, it's going to run the full query. So the cleaning process doesn't require you to work on large amount of data. You define it first and then get all the data. So it's not only convenience, it is faster also, inherently faster. So now I say edit, so it opens its own window. And then what happens? It shows me all the columns. Typically you will right click on the column you don't want and remove it, but this guy is smarter. You select columns which you want and then say remove other columns. So I'm going to keep this and this and area, and then you right click there and choose remove other columns. Done. Now you'll notice that this population has a very long name. I don't like it, so I can just edit it here. But even the fact that I changed the name is an operation. Notice what it did, table rename columns, and there is a step which is remembered. Now this is left aligned, means what? When I get it into Excel, it will be considered as text, and then I will be wasting time search replacing comma, which is the worst way of converting text to column number, by the way, but it still works, or whatever other method. So don't do that. Right click and say change type. How to do it is this guy's problem. Change type. Now this is latitude, longitude, but it has appeared in one column. So we can do split column from here itself based on a delimiter. In this case, it's a custom delimiter, forward slash. And then it will do the job. And then of course I can rename it. Now that I have got the data clean, I have all the steps remembered, I can say load the data. Then it will give you clean data, and that is the time it is going to run the full query to fetch the whole data. Now next time, this page obviously is not going to refresh because you don't add cities every day, but if it was a dynamic page, next time you want this, you just say refresh. You don't need to give the URL, you don't need to give the ETL steps, they are already remembered. And if you are using Office 365 with Power BI, if this query is something others need, then you right click there and say share. When you say share, this proper query with all the ETL already applied with source properly defined is now accessible to everyone who is using Power BI, so other users don't waste time doing this process also. So it's reuse of your effort across the enterprise. And there may be lot of data sources everyone creates and everyone shares it. Now how do you know which one is authentic or not? So there is a separate role in SharePoint called data steward. So whoever has data steward group membership gets a separate extra button there called authenticated or authorized certified. So you will see a separate icon for certified queries. So if I am a user and I don't trust other users' queries, I will only go to certified queries. So it gives you some governance also within the process. Okay, so that is quick introduction to Power Query, but it can do many other things. I don't have time to explain. For example, this was one example. What was it? We converted a cross tab to a tabular data. But typically you get cross tab like this. This was one department gave you budget, another gave you another cross tab, another gave you another cross tab. Now I'll have to do this four times and append them together. And while appending them together, I'll have to put one extra column called department. Otherwise I'll lose track of where it came from. That requires a little more sophisticated version of Power Query. I don't have time to show you that, but that is written in my blog. Read my blog, efficiency365.com. 380 articles, I write one every day. I have not written for last few days because I have been running around, but I will do it on weekend. So that is quickly about Power Query. Now let's go to Power View and the other guys. So when the data is large, obviously users can't handle it. So if you have a 7 million record set, either users have to split it into 1 million files and then struggle with combining 7 pivot tables, or you have to approach IT to make a data warehouse or something like that out of it. Now we have a choice, that's called Power Pivot. So Power Pivot is a database engine sitting inside Excel. If you are using 2010, you have to install it. If you are using 13, it is built in. You just have to enable the checkbox in COM add-ins in tools options. Once you do that, the concept is simple. Wherever the data is lying, make an empty Excel file. Don't even attempt to import data into Excel. Even if the source is in Excel, import it into Power Pivot. So Power Pivot has a data model, a mini database engine. So you go there, import the data there and make a pivot table from there. That's the idea. Today what do? We get the data in Excel, we make a tabulars and then we make a pivot table. That concept has changed. So now where do I get data from? So I'll show you all the sources, all databases. Now this list is a little different than Power Query list, you will notice. Databases are common, but notice if you have a SQL Server data warehouse, this guy can directly connect to it, not BO. BO is Power Query, SQL Server is this. If you have a SSRS report, which is a .rdl file, you can that also can be a source. Azure, yes. And then Atom feeds, and least common denominator Excel and text. So what is the idea? You get the raw data in wherever it is available from. So one piece comes from a data warehouse, another piece comes from a text file, third piece comes from Excel. Get them here, create relationships and then create a pivot table. That's the idea.
But the BO is not here.
BO, you go to Power Query, import it into Power Query, and when I go to Power Query, it gives me two options. Do you want to put the data into Excel sheet or do you want to put the data in Power Pivot data model? So you directly put it in Power Pivot data model. So wherever there is some extra special thing required, you go through Power Query. If you want to import it directly in Power Pivot, it assumes it is tabular and clean. If it is not clean, you clean it through the ETL engine called Power Query and then put it into data model. So just to show you what happens when I am running a query in Power Query, just to digress to explain what you are asking me. To give you one example which we just used, I use this, correct, expense type, and we made it into a tabular data by saying unpivot. So if I do that unpivot, what did it do? It made tabular data, we saw that just now. But I said load, I didn't specify where to load. So default you can define, of course, but if you don't define it, then the default is called in the workbook. So now notice, I clicked on close and load, so it loaded it in Excel worksheet. There is a drop down, you say close and load to, and then this is what it gives you. If you say this, obviously it goes into Excel. You can put it in Excel sheet and the data model if you like, but there is very rarely a case to do both, because you either use this or that. Now if you don't do this, you can neither put it here nor there, just define the query. When are you going to do that? When I have five such sheets to be unpivoted and combined together. I'll create five queries and then go to the first query and say append the second, third, fourth, and then I'm going to import. So sometimes you just define the definition and use it for further operations. So if you directly want to add to data model, you just click on this guy and job done. So that is the question you have to decide. Now, if you want to use traditional pivot table, you put it in Excel sheet. If you want to use data model and power pivot, you put it in data model. That's the idea. So now we'll go and see what this guy does. So before you do that, let me show you a common example where power pivot can be useful. If the data is large, file size becomes large, correct? And everything becomes slow. So if a large pivot table, not even 1 million, half a million also, or even lesser, drag drop will take ages. File opening will take ages. Editing will wait and wait and wait. So when that happens, that means you need power pivot. That's one requirement. Second requirement is to eliminate unwanted VLOOKUPs, which are used for decoding IDs. What do I mean by that? So power pivot is an alternative to one more commonly required thing called VLOOKUP related things. So now I get transactional data like this, country ID, product ID, whatever. Now if I create a pivot table out of this, it'll work, but I can't show the product name and country name. That is lying somewhere else with me in some other Excel sheet. This is the so-called product master and this is the so-called country master, correct? Now, normal pivot table cannot take this piece of data and this piece of data. It only takes one piece of data. So in that piece of data, I have to add a new column and then I have to do a VLOOKUP to get that name from that country master. That's where we use VLOOKUP. That is called decoding because this is country code and you are decoding it to whatever the description. This is a common use of VLOOKUP, but it also has side effect. It makes the file size larger and slower. So now that is gone. So in this case, what do? You get both the pieces in power pivot and create a relationship like we do in a database. So I'll show you a combined example of all that, large data plus relationships. To save time, I already have a file. I will show you that. This is a 43 MB file. Remember the size. And I show you the data. So these are slices. This is a pivot table. This is a chart. But the data is not in the Excel sheet. It is in Power Pivot. So let's go there and look at what we have. And I have one more T. Okay, so what do we see? This looks like Excel grid, but this is Power Pivot. What is the constraint here? You cannot edit anything. You cannot clean anything. Once the data is clean, you import it into Power Pivot. Now I have multiple tabs here. Each tab is a table. So this is my sales table, which has all the transactional data, product ID, store ID, channel ID, whatever. I have also imported the channel master, which has only four rows. This is the channel key. So now how do I eliminate VLOOKUP? I go to the channel ID on the one-to-many-many side, which is the transactional table, right-click there and say create relationship. So the fact table date key is same as channel master channel key. That is how I define the relationship. Only left outer joins allowed, nothing else. Many-to-many you have to decode into a middle table. So if you don't want to do it like this, and especially for users who may not understand all this, there is a visual way of doing it that is called data diagram. So even here you can drag drop and create relationships. The mistake users do here is they don't understand which is the one part and which is the many part. You should drag from many into one. That's the idea. Having done all this, now you can make a pivot table, but let's look at the data size. How many rows these tables have? So this channel table is very small. Date table has this. Date table is, by the way, the date dimension table. Normally in data warehouse, we create a date table with all the first is a key and then everything else. Similar table works here also for time intelligence functions. So these are small tables. The fact table is the big one, which is almost 4 million rows. So in spite of it being 4 million rows, we are able to handle the data in Excel and the file size is just 43 MB. In normal course, if you had attempted to import it in 4 sheets, it would have been much bigger. So this guy basically creates an in-memory cube and does a lot of compression. That's why this is happening. So now that we have everything done, we will create a pivot table from here. It's already there, but I'll create a fresh one. And just to show you the performance, we'll go to the fact table last. Let's create the structure for the pivot table first and then put the fact data. So I'm going to start with product category name. I'm also going to put channel above it. And let me also put product subcategory. That'll make it long enough. So how many rows do we have now? Okay. How many rows? 1384 rows of data, pivot table. I'll also put something in the column to make it wider. I have still not touched the fact table, so it is happening quite fast. Now this will add entities in the column area, whatever they are. How many columns are these? How many columns? PH means? How do you find out the column number? It's Excel, no? There must be a function to find column number. So type equal to and type C, O, and then it shows. Empty function. 425 columns and 1400 whatever rows. So this is a big pivot table I have created. I'm zooming out to show you the processing which will now happen. So now when I go to sales table, which has 4 million rows, and I'm just going to drag drop total sales, this is the thing which will show you performance. I'm dropping it now. 1, 2, 3. 3 seconds for processing 4 million rows and give you output 1400 rows by 400 columns. What does that mean? End user can do large amount of data analytics without troubling IT, provided you take the trouble of teaching them how to do it. Someone has to take that, otherwise people will not even enable that Power Pivot checkbox in add-ins, and everyone is still copy-pasting manually and wasting their lives in spite of having the technology in hand. So this is Power Pivot. This also has one very, very important thing. Of course, it has many things, but from a BI point of view, it gives you KPIs and it gives you calculated fields like measures. We used to, in data warehousing terms, it's called measures, right? But in data warehousing terms, what happens? Thank you. What happens is everything is pre-calculated, correct? What is a data warehouse? All possible queries are pre-calculated, and then you drag drop, it just has to find it and give it. But this is Excel, it doesn't work exactly like that. And end users are never going to understand MDX syntax. So now what Microsoft did is equivalent things they made as Excel functions. So they added 100 odd extra functions which work only in the context of Power Pivot. That language is called DAX, D-A-X. So when you go to calculated columns, you see these functions. Some of them are similar to what Excel has, some of them are special. Now remember, there is a date dimension table already. Assuming you have that, you get lot of functions. But let's start simple. Many people want count distinct. Distinct count is not available in normal Excel. In 2013 it is available, but otherwise not. So distinct count is a direct function available now. Similarly, very often we have lots of transactions and then we want to find opening balance by month, opening balance by quarter, year. They are direct functions there. And then these functions, when you define, they don't get calculated because they have not yet been dropped into a pivot table. When you drop them in the pivot table, they understand what is the context, what is there in row, what is there in column, what is there in filter area, and then they calculate themselves. So unlike normal Excel functions which give you the result immediately, these guys give result only if they are used in a pivot table. So they are context sensitive functions. So another very powerful function for financial or sales reporting is parallel period, where this quarter versus same quarter last year, last to last year. So you have a generic function. This is the date table. This is number of intervals and this is the type of interval. Just define it and drag drop. It will do the job. So if you really want to effectively use this, you will have to learn this language. I'm not expecting all users to understand it, but at least the BI team should, so that they can deliver solutions on this, because solutions here are much faster to develop than a data warehouse. There is no processing time, correct? And this could as well be almost like live. You go to Power Pivot and say refresh, it's going to refresh all this. So these are the DAX functions. You have to learn them separately, because if you know MDX, you will learn it faster, obviously, but still the syntax has to be learned. So this is quick introduction to pivot table. There are power pivot. Now we go to.
So talk about the point is again, this will be processed on your desktop, right? So it
yes.
On the memory and your.
Yes. Okay. So I just processed 4 million rows in 3 seconds. So of course my machine doesn't look primitive. This is a workstation. So it is 16 GB, 8 core. But everyone is not going to get this machine. But even if that machine is 20 times slower, what I did in 3 seconds, maybe it takes 1 minute, it is still an achievement for an end user, because they wait for hours or they give up saying I can't analyze more than 2 years of data because it's practically impossible. So apart from time saving, it is increasing capability, it is increasing the horizon of analytical sample size in the context of users. And if you take larger amount of data, whatever you analyze, you forecast, you plan is more accurate because the sample is larger. So it's increasing capability at end user level, not just saving time.
So, if we upload this to say SharePoint.
Yes.
Can you use SharePoint?
Yes, absolutely. Whatever you saw in the pivot table is available as interactive SharePoint.
Okay.
On the same whatever browsers and whatever we saw. So before we go to Power View and Power Map, let me show you the SharePoint relationship with what we just did. So let me go to SharePoint and open a file. I'm first going to open it in Excel. How do you deliver reports today? Typical end user, how do they deliver reports today? They get the data in Excel, struggle with it, make pivot tables, make pivot charts, and then what do they send and how do they send to whoever needs it? What is happening today? Send how?
Email.
And because your email may have a limit on the size of the file you can attach, sometimes the file size is going to exceed that limit. So what do? Go to pivot tables and paste as values. Go to charts, paste as pictures, and then send it. Now one part is solved because it is a small file. But what is lost? Analytics is lost. The other side can't do anything. It's a static report. So we are losing in that process. Second part is, if you send reports by mail, you are going to send mail to those people every month, quarter, week, whatever is the period. Looking at backdated reports is going to be confusing. Multiple versions floating around, email system overloaded, storage overloaded, archival overloaded. Even if Microsoft is giving you 50 GB mailbox now, doesn't mean we misuse it. We should use it correctly, no? So there is an alternative. So now I have raw data. This is what a user does. Gets the raw data, makes some report, and now I have to send it to others. Normally I would go to file, send, mail attachment. I don't want to do that. So I go to save as, and notice now if you are using 2013, it is as easy to store on OneDrive or a SharePoint site as it is to store on my computer. So there is no excuse that it is more cumbersome. You don't have to go to browser page, you don't have to copy paste URLs, no struggle. First time you log in, it remembers all this. If you want to not even give that effort to people, you can populate these using group policy also. Anyway, I have saved this already. Now if I want to share it, I share it from here. I say invite people, and then I just put their names here, and they say what is the permission. I don't have to go to that weird SharePoint permission dialogue traditional to do this, because even IT people get confused. They really were so end users. This dialogue is not coming in a browser, remember, it's coming in Excel. So the best feature of Office 2013 is integration with SharePoint. Remember, till now SharePoint was there for 10 years, but nobody used it because it was cumbersome to use. Now there is no excuse. Not only that, it even markets the benefits of SharePoint. Now because this file is on SharePoint, I still insist on emailing it. Notice what it is telling you. Do you want to send it as attachment or do you want to send it as link? And it is marketing the benefits of that. That is how you design a software. Because nobody is going to help file to understand, so help file comes here. Microsoft could have get the same amount of money without writing these bullets also, but they are trying to educate users. Problem is, nobody looks at this. So that problem is still not solved, because people have to be told that everything you see is for your benefit. The attitude of every user is, what I know is enough and what I don't know is useless. Unless you change that mindset, all the technology is useless. Anyway, so having done this, now I send that link, someone gets the link, and then they click on the link. What do they see? That is the next question. Now, by default, in new version of Excel and new version of SharePoint rather, when I save a file, send a link, and someone goes and clicks on the link, what do they see? So I'm going to click here. It's as good as me clicking on the link in my email where I got the notification. It will open in Excel online by default. Of course, you can change the default, but it's a good default to have. So now notice what it is showing me. Original Excel file had 4 sheets. This guy is also showing me 4 sheets. But what did travel on the wire? Nothing. Even if this was a 50 MB file, what traveled on the wire? The HTML rendering of the first sheet is that traveled. Only when I click on this sheet, it is going to think of converting that to HTML and then render it. So irrespective of the file size now, at least performance is faster and lighter. And this is browser neutral, so it will work on iPad, Android as well. But the problem is, do I really want to show people raw data? So now I'll be tempted to copy paste only the final and then. Don't do that. Why? Because it has been thought of. You go to file in Excel. What do you see? Various things. One of the option is called browser view options. Nobody notices this guy. He's a very powerful guy here. So now what do you say? I decide what to show when people open this through Excel services on browser. By default entire, but I want to show only these 3 sheets, not the raw data. So one checkbox solves the problem. So now I save the file, and the same file on browser I will refresh. See what happened? Raw data gone. Does it mean it is deleted? No, it is not visible. That's all. If I have given permissions to the other party to edit it, I can always go and say edit in Excel, they will see everything. But if you have not given view permission, this option is not there, so you are safe. But then, this is better than before. But now notice, I have these 2 slicers which are lying on top of each other. If this was opened in Excel, I can move them around and do whatever I want. But now that it is rendered in browser, these guys don't move. I am stuck here. So now whatever has gone behind, I don't even know what I am filtering on. Problem. It will work, but I don't know what I am doing. Not only that, this is a pivot table, this is a chart, these are slices. That's all I have in this sheet. But what do I see here? More blank rows, more blank rows. You can keep paging down till you die, it will reach 1 million someday. What is the use of showing this stupidity? No use. So now Microsoft said even selecting sheets is not a nice way of doing it. So they found another beautiful way. To use that way, we have to discipline ourselves. Whenever you create a pivot table, you must give it a name. Like we give a table a name, you must give a pivot table a name. Analyze, there is a name. By default, it will be pivot table 1, 2, 3, but you change it. Even charts have names. Analyze menu has names. So remember to give sensible English names for them, or whatever, understandable business names. Having done that, go to the same old guy called browser view options. And in browser view options, we have a third option called items in this workbook. And now it shows you all the names. That's why you have to give proper names. Otherwise, it will be chart 1, chart 2. You yourself don't know what you are showing. So now I select 1, 2, 3, 4. Only 4 I want to show. Done. I save. And then I go to browser and refresh. Now see how dramatically the report changes. How many did I select? 4. Remember? Now no sheets are seen. No grid is seen. What do I see? 4 options. When I click on the option, it shows me the option. End of story. If I click here, it shows me this, the chart. If I click here, notice this guy in my Excel sheet, this was this sheet. This didn't have a slicer. Correct? So there is no slicer here. Whereas these guys have a slicer, this one. So if I go to browser and click on this guy, notice I got filters option here. And earlier those slicers were overlapping on top of each other. Now I can open and close them and do slicing from here. This interface is getting generated live. No programming has been done. This is how you deliver reports. There's nothing to do with BI or BI team, but someone has to do it and educate users that this is the best way. Now, it is not enough to educate users who create reports. It is also equally important to show this to people who consume reports. Because what will happen? If you do this, first time you send the link, everyone clicks on the link, they get January report. In February, what is going to happen? I am going to open the file from SharePoint. I am going to go to raw data, copy paste some data there, refresh my pivot tables and save the file. What am I going to send as a report second time? Nothing, because the link is not changed, the location of the file has not changed, the URL has not changed. But how will the other party know that you have finished the report? So now first time you send the report, you have to go to the bosses, go and log in through their account, click on the file and create an alert on that file. So next time you change the file, SharePoint will send an alert with the link saying report is ready. Understand the concept? But now, wait, I'll come. Sometimes we do incremental copy paste. I don't do Feb report only in the end of Feb. I get data on 10th of the month I append, again 20th of the month, again end, thrice I do. Now boss will get notification thrice. That will be irritating. So how do you solve that? When you enable versioning in SharePoint, there are concept of major version and minor version. By default, we enable major version. Major version means what? Any change will be reflected in notifications. But if you enable minor versions, whenever you make a change, SharePoint will ask you, is this a minor change or major change? So keep all the small changes as minor. Only when the final report is ready, save it as major. Only then the notification gets generated. Yes, you have a question. So for example, let me understand what you are asking. Suppose I have this particular what's happening? Let me
refresh.
Correct. Restricted by user, no?
Yeah.
So if you are showing various segments, depending on who has logged in, only those segments should be seen. Correct?
Yeah.
That's called security trimming. That is the job of enterprise grade data warehousing systems. It is not the job of SharePoint and Excel. That is the single most important difference between end user BI and enterprise BI. Security. If you have 5 reports and there are 5 clicks to be done, then using audiences in SharePoint, you cannot show those links to different people. That is based on Active Directory properties. That's audiences. But once you are in a report, no security trimming.
So Power BI also?
No security trimming at SharePoint and Excel level. Because they don't understand who you are in that sense. Who is going to put that extra where clause based on you? There is no where clause there. So far clear? Now we go to a new method of data analysis.
So, often in the case that say this table,
yes,
if you have to refresh it from our SAP system,
yes,
to business object tested,
yes,
does someone in Google refresh the report every day? Or is,
yes, if the way I showed you through Power Query, you connect to say BO,
yes,
and then make a Power Pivot and then you publish it on SharePoint. Even though it is on SharePoint, someone has to make that connection wake up and say refresh. That requires a component of Office 365 which you have to pay for extra called Power BI. In that you have scheduled refresh. The regular stuff, normal E3, don't have scheduled refresh. And even there the data sources are limited, so just read what are the limitations there. Now we go to different kind of data analysis. We already know pivot table, we know power pivot, we know how to publish it to SharePoint and how to manage the whole cycle. Now I'm taking a simple data which I showed you initially. This I could do analysis in pivot table also. What would I do? I'll make one by month, one by card type, one by category and put them as a dashboard. But I have a new method of doing it now. That's called Power View. This is only 2013. This requires Silverlight to be installed on the desktop. On the browser, it works on HTML5. So this gives you this much. That's it. It is the new sheet, but it is not a regular Excel sheet with rows and columns. This is the dashboard, so this is the dashboard surface. That's all you play with. And there is a filter area, which I am removing right now. What do you get here? It gives you the data model. Right now I have only one table, that's why it is showing me one table. If there were multiple, it would have shown me multiple. Now what do I do? Like pivot table, I can drag drop. But this behaves a little differently. But let me increase the size and use a different theme.
So the model is from there?
Power pivot.
Okay.
Data in power pivot is called data model. So now I just want to do simple pivot table like thing. So I drag and drop, let's say, type of card and amount. So what did it do? Something very similar to pivot table. But if I want to make a chart in pivot table, I have to retain the pivot table and then create a chart. Correct? You can't remove the pivot table and keep the pivot chart alive. Here you can convert this itself to a chart. That's step number one. Now because we have limited space, you decide how much space this deserves and you adjust. Similarly, I'm going to do a couple of more and different types of maps, different types of charts. Now notice, if you have too many items in a chart, in a pivot table or a pivot chart or traditional Excel chart, what will happen? Those bars will become so thin that you can't make sense out of it if the chart is crowded. This chart never gets crowded because it gives you a scroll bar. Similarly, I am doing one for city and amount. And we will do a column chart. So quickly I created a visual dashboard. I could have done it using pivot table and pivot chart also, but that would have required little more jugglery and arrangement and manual work. So far it has not given me much benefits, but let's see what happens now. If this was four pivot charts and then I wanted to analyze only by platinum card, I would have to go to all these three pivot tables, drag drop platinum as a filter area and then select platinum, platinum, platinum. Now I don't need to do that. I just click on platinum, everything else gets filtered. This is automatically linked to each other, no manual work. So it's like every item which is plotted is implicitly a filter. You click anywhere, that becomes the filter, everything else reflects it. Now
slice
you
slicer
kind of thing is there, I'll show you. This is sort of visual slicer now, correct? You can do control click also and have two of them. Or this is a city, I can make this a slicer and this a slicer. So multi-select within the component, not across components. So this is very simple, but from a user point of view, with very minimal effort, it gives them more insights. And what is BI all about? Learning every useful piece of information from the past so that you can improve future. That never happens in reality, but this increases the chances of that happening because it's so easy, people will be tempted to play with it more and learn more about the data. When the initial fashionable part wears off, then people will start using it functionally more. Now this is one aspect of it. Now, because this space is limited, you cannot increase the size of this rectangle. Because as you know, dashboard should not have scroll bars. But now if I want to see anything in detail, there is a pop-out button here. Temporarily it becomes full screen and comes back on demand. So in that sense, you can increase the available space on demand. This doesn't have all the features of Excel charts. These are very primitive charts if you look at charting only as a capability. So you can't do data labels, you can't put gradient there, you can't put all the stuff we can do in Excel chart, you can't do here. But this is designed for quick analysis and interlinkages rather than the professional charting thing. So now, how are we seeing this? Like this. But this is not the only way. This guy is very powerful and it gives you different things. For example, right now I'm just going to keep card type and very full screen. Now I want to see this pie chart by category of transaction. Now notice what I'm doing. If I put it as tile by, this is a new field, what happens is on top you get something like a filter. Okay? If I say this, this is getting filtered by whatever I am selecting. But right now I can see only one at a time because it's a filter. If I don't want that, I remove it from tile and put it in what is called as slices. But that's generally very bad because it's going to break it down within. So there are five categories, so each pie is divided into five pieces. Right now this is random data, so distribution is almost equal, but you understand the meaning. But this is very visually confusing. So now there is a new option. If I put category in vertical multiples, this is a new area available, vertical multiples. If I put this guy there, notice what happens. Right now we have only one big pie chart showing by card. Now what happens? It gets five pie charts for each category. Technically, I could have done this in any version of Excel, but who is going to draw five pie charts by creating five pivot tables, putting the same filter, changing one by one? Nobody is going to do it, but now it's easy. Now if I do it again by, let's say, year, I have 2 years of data. Notice what happens. This is 2013 and 14, and this is cash fill grocery not fitting in, so you get scroll bar. So it can multiply any visualization very quickly by putting the right thing in the multiplier item. That's the idea. Now if this gold card and platinum card and silver card was in tile area, there is another option. You may have a physical photograph of how the gold card looks or a platinum card looks. So if you go to data model and if you have a column which has the URL of the image, you can identify that column as a picture URL, and that picture will be visible here. So you can integrate pictures into reports by using that facility. Right now I'm not going to show you that, but just remember that. So this is called multipliers. Then this has drill down also. So let's do a simple thing. Let's start with card type and amount. Very simple. And this is a simple stacked column chart. I put it full screen. So gold, platinum, silver. Now if I had done this in pivot table, the same thing would have happened. Card type and amount. And I could have drawn a simple bar chart like this. Now if I drag and drop city, what would happen? There will be so many bars, you will not be able to understand anything. Now notice what happens here in Power View. If I drag and drop city below card type, nothing happens. Now I'm going to drag category, nothing happens. I'm going to drag month, nothing happens. So what is going to happen? As of now, nothing. What I just defined is the drill down order. That will show itself only when you actually drill down. So now this is platinum card, whatever is the amount. When I double click on it, it will go to the next guy. What was that city? So this is only for platinum, it is showing you city distribution. Now if I say particular city Colombo, now it's platinum Colombo distribution it is showing. And then in grocery, platinum, whatever Colombo, and whatever that category was, fuel, and then so you have a drill up and a drill down functionality. If you change your mind and you want to drill in different way, you can say month wise I want first, then I want card category, then I want card type, and then city. So now it's reverse. Now it's May, within that fuel, within that platinum, and within that Colombo. So very quick drill up, drill down definition. Of course you can do it in data warehousing systems also, but it requires more processing, more work, and more formal definition. This is ad hoc because it's end user. So now let's keep city and see what happens. This is good. This is alphabetical, not very nice. So there is a small little thing here. Say I don't want by city, I want by amount, and ascending or descending. So now I am seeing descending order of amount. This is also not nice. So you just click on map, then it will draw the map. Unfortunately, some city has gone into US. So we'll see what that is. It has not understood what Colombo means. So when that happens, what do? You go to that particular offending thing and then you select all the rows and edit it and put comma and put country name. Means put some additional locational identifier, the next level, whatever it is. So if it is a city, then you put district. If it is a district, you put state. If it is a state, you put country, like that. And then you refresh this, refresh data. Then it will understand. Now it has come here. Okay. Now this is much better view than the bar chart, because this shows geographical distribution. If your business context doesn't require geographic distribution, then it's okay. But if you have something geographically distributed, you can't say I don't need to see geographic distribution. We were not seeing it because it was not possible to do earlier. So this is a new capability. This is not time saving in any way. This gives you a new picture of what you are doing and helps you understand things in a completely different perspective, making you take better or different decisions. Now this is overall picture. I want to see it by card type. So I can put it as tile, in which case, like we saw earlier, this is gold, this is platinum, this is silver. Or alternatively, I could have put it as color, in which case these guys will become pie charts. And then each pie chart will tell me gold, italic or whatever. When you go there, it zooms in to show details. Or another alternative you would have is, don't put this card type as color, put it as vertical multiples. And then what happens? You will see three charts side by side. And if I now want to see it by year, I could have put that in horizontal multiples. So it will draw as many charts as required. Now it is up to you whether it makes sense or not. Just because technology allows doesn't mean we do it. So it depends on what you want. So this is how this works. So let's keep one chart, one thing. And I'll put two things here. We have done this before. Two pie charts here. Now, what did we do earlier? When we clicked on a pie chart, what happened? Everything else got filtered. The same thing works in map also. See, the sizes and locations are changing. Right now everything is in every location, that's why some dots are not going away, but it will be dynamic. And if I click here, this also will show you contribution by city, and control click works here also. Now if you are doing this on iPad, this will work on iPad browser also and Android browser also. But how will you do control click? There is no control button on iPad. So if you are rendering this on Safari, there will be a small button here which says multi-select. It's like a toggle. So you touch that first and then you do multi-select. So it's all the things have been thought of already. Now all this is good. Now I want to see what. What is this? Card type and amount. What is this? Category and amount. What is this? City and amount. Now I want to look at my amounts. This is the amount. And I want to see what is happening there. So let me clear this filter. I want to see the amounts in ascending order just to check the range. So minimum is 24 rupee transaction, maximum is 10,000. So it's a wide range of transactions I am looking at. I want to see the picture only for high value transactions. Now what do I need? Right now, everything I click on is a filter, but this is a category filter. I want a value filter now. All of them have one thing in common. We are plotting amount, and now I want to filter by amount. So that's why there is a separate filter area which I have not shown till now. Now I drag and drop amount here. Notice how intelligent this is. This doesn't show the traditional greater than less than thing. It shows me the minimum and maximum. I didn't have to go to my raw data and sort it to understand it. Now I know I want to see only high value. So I just drag this guy and put it here. And notice, I will do this without zoom so you'll understand what happens. Everything changed. So this is how high value picture looks. This is how not so high. This is middle. this is low, this is very low, this is absolutely low. Make sense?
No.
Is it useful? Absolutely, absolutely. So you want to see this in SharePoint? Absolutely. So where is my SharePoint? This is, I forgot where I posted it. Hold on. Ah, here it is. So this is the Power View with map. I am browsing. This is on browser. Now right now this is rendering Silverlight because this is Microsoft browser. Okay? This is a browser rendering. Same thing works. Now you'll see, if I have defined the filter, you will see a filter area also. Now if I want HTML5, I can try here. This is the HTML5 view. Now I'll go to Chrome and try to use the same URL. But before that, let's see iPad also. Same sheet.
So what's the main difference between Power BI and functionality?
All those power something somethings are called Power BI, put together along with SharePoint. So the additional payment you give to Power BI as a component of on top of E3, whatever I have shown you is not extra payment. If you have E3 and Excel, this is all happening. If you have made a query in Power Query and you want to share it across the enterprise, then you need that component. If you need a data steward to certify queries, you need that component. If you want to identify some reports and identify them as favorites, then you need that. And that guy gives you some forecasting and trending analysis also, which is only available through that component. And it gives you English query, so you can actually type in English and then it will understand and render it. Those are the extra benefits of it. And it gives you more capacity for uploading larger files. So this is the, what is happening? Why is it not showing? This is on iPad, same report. Okay, same concept. But now I have to multi-select something. You see that small little dot which came on top. If I want to see multi-select, first I touch that. Sorry. Now it becomes select more than one item. Now I can touch this and this. The concept is same. Now if I go to filter area, I don't know if I have defined a filter area, let's see. Notice there is a filter area also, but I don't think I have defined any filter. Never mind. So this is how it works. Same thing in Android. Now iPad also has Excel, full Excel, editable, free. There this will not render, remember. Because that requires Silverlight and that is not supported on iPad as a platform. And within Excel, it doesn't support HTML5. That has to be on a browser. That's why it will work on Safari on iPad, but it will not work on the Excel which is available for iPad. That's the idea.
And for Now, Dr. Kim,
yes.
Native client for Power BI.
Native client for Power BI? Yes. What is that? I don't know.
I think that now, yesterday, as the client for Android and
No. What was introduced yesterday was Office for Android tablets. Right now, if I go to this guy, see what I have. I have Word, Excel, PowerPoint for iPad. Earlier also it was available. But only if you have Office 365 subscription, you could edit it. Otherwise, only read. Now they made it free, whether you have Office 365 or not. That is Office for iPad. But equivalent of this Office for Android tablet wasn't there. That preview was released yesterday. Okay, so that is that. So now there is one last component left. That is called Power Map. Already we saw map, but there is a dedicated mapping software available now, free download from Microsoft. That will work on 13. So same data. This time I go to not Power View. Next to it, if you have installed it, you will see Power Map. This guy has his own data sheet. And this doesn't get rendered on SharePoint. It needs its dedicated client and only works on desktop, nowhere else. So this requires DirectX, not Silverlight. So this guy has already picked up our data. Because there was a column called city, it checked whether it has cities and it has already plotted the cities on the globe. What is the difference between the map we saw earlier and this one? That was a 2D map, this is a 3D map. You can move it around. You can zoom in, zoom out, do whatever you like. So far clear? No names yet. So you say show me labels. So it will put labels also. You want to see terrain. Depending on your business, you may want to see actual hills and the sea and all that. Maybe in hospitality it matters, or construction it matters. Then you change the theme. This theme gives you aerial map. So not only will it show your cities, it will actually show you the terrain. But right now you'll notice that it has just plotted the city. There is no data has plotted as such. It has pointed to the cities. So in the next step, you choose what you want to plot. So now I am just going to zoom out. And let's change the color of this blue thing to something else later. I'm just going to say amount. So notice what happened. It put 3D bar chart on top of it. Now, because this is green and blue, it's not looking nice. Let's make something different. Now it will look better. But now I'm seeing from top. I can't make out anything. So you can change the elevation. You can rotate it around. And then zoom in, zoom out, do whatever you feel like. This is called Power Map. There's only one bar chart right now. Now I want to see card type, that is category. So this becomes stacked bar chart now. If you don't like stacked, you can make it side by side. You can make it a pie chart. You can make it a color scale. Or you can identify region. If it was a district, it would identify region by color like that. So this is one way of doing it. Now, if this is the case, we have a date column. We have never used it in any analysis so far. So let's look at the date column. Sort it. This is 1 year of data, starting with 2nd September and ending with 2nd September 14. 1 year of data. Now, till now we have not used the date column. Now, what does this have? This shows who decides the height of the bar. Right now it is decided by amount. Who decides the color coding? That is decided by this. So, card type is platinum, silver, whatever. There is a third guy called who understands the time. So I put a date thing in time. So now I show it without zoom so you'll understand. This is without the date being added. This is with the date being added. Do you see any difference? It flickers a little but finally shows the same chart. Now what is it showing here? This is showing me Which date?
End date.
End date. So what is it showing? This picture is a cumulative picture as on this date. Now, of course, I don't want to see time, so I'm going to remove this and only keep the date. So it will show you that. Now, if I press play button, see what happens. It's actually replaying your data live. Now, if you want to see yourself, of course, you can drag it and see as on 23rd January, this was the case. Then what changed? You can actually see what is changing. So there is like action replay, fast forward. Now you can also have different items there. Just to clarify this, I am showing. Notice right now every row it is traversing in the data and plotting it. So it's going through data row by row and plotting it wherever it belongs. And if there is already data, it's increasing the height. So it's cumulative. But sometimes you want to see as the transactions happen without any background baggage, as it happens. No accumulation. So you can say show it only for an instant. Now see what happens. Individual transactions are being shown and erased, shown and erased, shown and erased. Depends on the business situation what you want. And there is a third option. It will keep the bar unless it is replaced by something else. So this is the third one. It is little more stable because unless data of that type comes, the previous one remains. Got it? Now let's say you want to do all this and you want to do sort of a presentation. You are launching a new product and you want to say, okay, I will start launch from here. So you adjust it so that it is visible. And then you say, next, what do I want to see? That is a new scene. So I say, okay, next I want to go here. So I adjust this guy, I rotate it, adjust it, whatever I want to do. Then I add another scene, I go to the southern side. Again rotate it to make it look better, change the elevation, whatever. And then the last step, I want to show the whole country. So I add one more scene and then I want to show overall picture. Now I have created four scenes here, like we say slides in PowerPoint, like that. Now each scene has settings. What is the time it is going to take? These are called scene options. How much is the scene going to last? And is there a transition effect? By default, no transition effect. So I'm putting circle as the effect here, just to show you different effects. Here I'm going to show fly over as the effect. Here I'm going to put
Dolly
as the effect. Dolly is a camera term in cinematography. And push in. And of course you can increase or decrease the speed, and when you have defined all this, it will do the job. Full screen. This is called Dolly. Let's like, and this is called push in. Understand? And if you want to share it with someone, just say create video, choose the resolution by MP4 file. So this is called Power BI. So I guess you must finish now because it's Friday night. So if you have any questions, please ask. You want to try connecting and see what happens, or you already done that? So basic idea is I have already asked him to download Power Query. Okay. Now you know how it works, so you can connect to a universe and figure it out. Now the issue is yours is a data warehouse. It's multidimensional. Mm-hmm. Now multidimensional thing cannot be combined with flat data. So whenever you go and choose anything from a data warehouse, it automatically flattens the data. And then users can use it with other types of data. That eliminates the need of what is happening today. Today what is happening? You have a data warehouse. You have a nice front end on top of it. It is multidimensional. It gives you drill down, drill up, everything you want. But what do users want? They will copy paste that data, put it in Excel, and then they want to combine it with some other CSV file or some master data in Excel. Now rather than doing it by copy paste, do it through this. So in data model, one piece comes from BO, another piece comes from CSV, third piece comes from some budget file in Excel, and then life is good. That is the concept. Okay. Questions or finish?
Question? So, Doctor, one thing is that we are looking at to see if we can replace maybe BO.
No.
At least a front end tool.
No. I am trying to reduce the struggle at end user level because they are struggling in spite of having BO.
No, we want to see the possibility.
I wouldn't say that is possible because security is a problem. And of course, you need lot of ETL to be done. Power Query is better than nothing, but it is not a full-fledged ETL tool. Some things you have to do back-end processing and process the warehouse and keep it ready. That this guy is not capable of. Although it handles large amount of data, it is not going to handle server-side kind of data. All the processing is happening in client, remember.
End user tool, like
this. Yes.
If they can connect to Universe and Universe.
Correct.
Visualization themselves and share.
Absolutely. So what you have to do now is you already know what you are doing on the data warehousing side. What you have probably not done is do a detailed study of what people are doing with that BO stuff. So you have to see user level what are they doing after copy pasting. And then see that copy paste, can it be eliminated using these tools.
So you are saying if you have Power BI, then you can connect to Universe and
yes. There will be some situations where they are not using BO data.
Yeah.
That can be directly done through this. Where there is a combination, that also can be done through this. And there may be some other data which is there in LOB applications, SAP, wherever, where it is being pushed to people as CSV files. CSV files should be eliminated by creating a BCS connector, Business Connectivity Services on SharePoint, which virtualizes the connection between user and the database. So user connects to data connection library, data connection library connects to a database through BCS. So it gets virtualized. So from database point of view, you have one read-only user and nobody knows the username password. So whatever you are delivering as CSV dumps through IT should ideally go through SharePoint BCS or data connection library or both. That guarantees, for example, let's say you have a company which has 200 branches or whatever, 200 products. Who has the product master? The real product master is lying in the LOB database, ERP, wherever it is. That is the live one. But do people have select star access to that? No. So at some point of time in life, they grab that from somewhere and put it as an Excel file on their machine. That master never gets updated. So if you say product wise report and ask 5 people to give different reports but one column is product, their products themselves will not match. Because everyone is doing an offline local cache of whatever they feel is the master, which is never the latest. So now masters can be delivered to people as SharePoint list behind which there is BCS connectivity. That's another opportunity. And as a developer, you must be generating reports also, not necessarily through BO, through whatever system you have. Other than BO.
Yeah.
Or even BO may have an export to Excel option. But what happens when you export to Excel? Typically, if you say SAP reports, all of them have an export to Excel option. Correct? But all the reports are originally designed with printing in mind. Correct? No report is designed with printing not in mind for some reason. So now what happens? If you say export to Excel, the stream which would otherwise have gone to PRN port is dumped into Excel. That is that useful data in Excel? No, it is the worst possible format of data. So now what happens? People get data like this. This is a typical ERP report. Correct? Now users don't know what is what. They think I want this tabular data, I don't care about these headers, footers, so they are wasting their life selecting and deleting. Now if they eventually select and delete, what are they producing? tabular data. In your LOB database, that tabular data is already there. And people are wasting their lives recreating data which you already have in good format. So generating reports and exporting to Excel in simple terms is called spoiling the data and giving it to the user so that their life is spoiled further. This is a defeat of technology. Why are you not doing anything about it? Because no user came to you and told you that this is a problem. And you generated the report because they asked for it. So it is nobody's fault but everyone's fault. So if you want to do something good for the users, this is what you do. If you are creating reports from any system, whatever may be the platform, this is what we do. In any LOB application, the data is normalized, correct, for a good performance. When you have to generate a report, you write a query first. That query will do what? Combine multiple tables, do whatever is required, and then create a... Now we take that denormalized record set and then spoil the data by putting it in a report writer, whatever that report writer is. And that report writer proudly has an option called export to Excel. Now as a report, yes, this output is required, but export to Excel should happen from here. That is the single important thing any developer can do to make people's life easier. You don't have to do anything extra. You have the record set. Just give that when you say report export to Excel. Because if you don't give it, people are manually creating that record set by deleting unwanted stuff. So this applies to all reports, not necessarily BOR, SAP, whatever, homegrown applications also.